Recorded Books presents Crime of the Ancient Marinara by Stephanie Cole, narrated by Morgan Hallett. Chapter 1. 5 o'clock, early October. There were six of us assembled for final preparations in the common room of the Villa Orlandini on a hillside just outside of Cortona, Italy. The villa was home to Chef Claudio Orlandini, his Cornell-educated olive-growing son, Pete, and an assortment of helpful women of the Bari family, not the least of which was the redoubtable Anna Maria, the 60-ish sous chef who had been keeping the Orlandini household humming along for decades. Not quite a month ago, I, Nell Valenti, had been transatlantically wooed by a lawyer representing the Orlandinis to come to Cortona, Italy, and develop a world-class cooking school at their villa. 500 years ago, the property was home of the Order of St. Veronica of the Vale, but that was back in the day when the joint was a run-down convent and not the fine, run-down villa it was today. And now, I thought, here we were, on the eve, on the brink, very possibly even on the ledge, for all I knew. Chef, Pete, Anna Maria, Rosa, Sophia, and I. Chef dubbed the theme for our first intensive Marinara Misteriosa. This culinary virtuoso had found himself longing for the days of his explosive rocketing onto the culinary world stage back in his 20s, when his own secret marinara recipe was introduced to Italian sauce lovers the world over, who instantly proclaimed it the finest advancement in marinara development in the last 200 years. Love, fame, and money followed. But now, I had my doubts. How many people, I argued, are going to spring for round-trip airfare plus our fees, not to mention clear their own schedules at short notice, for 4 days at the villa to learn something they could probably figure out at home just by popping the lid on a jar of Newman's Own? The answer came within days of launching the website. Five Americans signed up. When I announced to Chef, the Baris, and Pete that Marinara Misteriosa was a go, Chef kissed both my cheeks. And now here we were, meandering around the common room with our hands in our pockets, taking care of last-minute tasks, eyeballing the beautiful changes to the space, on the afternoon before the five Americans showed up who were paying top dollar to be in the presence of the first real celebrity chef. Well, from Tuscany, under 200 pounds, and born less than 5 years after the death of Mussolini. To make my life a little easier, I decided to go with the Cucina van, owned and operated out of Florence by Manny Manfredi, whose gastro-tour services would include handling the money, coordinating airport pickups and drop-offs, transportation to and from the villa, and whatever foodie hotspots and shrines he could offer to our students along the way. At 2 p.m. the next day, Cucina van was arriving from Florence with our first class of American gastro-tourists. 4 days, 5 students, learning at the sauce-stained knees of renowned chef Claudio Orlandini. How hard could it be? And if we hit a few snags, as chef himself would say, tutto fa brodo, everything makes broth. The first time I heard chef use the common Italian phrase, I knew we had our brand. And it gave me a little frisson of pleasure. Everything makes broth. 3 weeks ago, that outside wall had been stripped of its peeling wallpaper, washed, dried, and painted a bright teal in chalkboard paint. I found a sign painter in Siena who did the lettering in gold leaf centered high up on the gorgeous teal wall. Tutto fa brodo, with plenty of slants and serifs to make the Orlandini Cooking School brand glisten with all the agelessness of a fresco. I crossed my arms, amazed at the changes. No more muschio, the moss that had been providing the 3D effect on the moist walls. No more mildew. Luscious rugs and geometric whites and golds offset the wall hanging. Stainless steel work tables doubling as desks glinted in the daylight. And Bauhaus metal and slingback leather chairs outdid anything I ever owned, that was for sure. For a moment, my heart picked up a beat, and I thought the Villa Orlandini Cooking School might really stand a chance. Today, down at the far end of the wall, near where the American foodies would put up their throbbing feet at the end of a tough day with polenta, Rosa and Sophia, Anna Maria's sisters who were members of the Order of the St. Veronica of the Veil, were 15 feet off the ground on rickety ladders, hanging a 10-by-12-foot tapestry banner in a famous William Morris Oriental design. Clustered below, shouting directions and gesturing as broadly as a traffic cop, was Anna Maria. "More this way, more that way, higher, lower. Are you drunk?" When we all finally agreed that the banner was as straight as we could get it without either a carpenter's level or an infusion of tea, we flopped into chairs and waited for Anna Maria to wheel her tea cart with extravagant antipasti aboard. Nibbling on a pepperoncino, the stalwart Rosa thumbed the remote and navigated her way to a cable TV channel, then upped the volume as though she had a twitch. And we all stared at Rosa's daily fix of a closed-captioned American show called Stealth Chef. "Ecco stealth," she stage-whispered, as though drawing our attention to a shadowy image of the Blessed Virgin on the side of an Arkansas barn. Stealth Chef, face obscured by a black bandana, hair obscured by a professional black head wrap, voice distorted by a high-tech voice changer, had hit on a gimmick that was sheer kitsch. But it worked, and it sold, and it topped late-afternoon cable culinary shows. I had to admit, Chef Orlandini's merry little Tutto Fabrodo brand looked a little ho-hum alongside Stealth Chef's brand, splayed across the simple set kitchen. Recipes for all. This anonymous dicer slicer, filming from an undisclosed location in the United States, was dubbed the Robin Hood of celebrity chefs. While waiting for the pasta pot to boil, the disguised voice lost no opportunity to plug the shtick. "Recipes belong to everyone," the figure mincing garlic intoned sincerely. "Nothing hidden, nothing withheld, the democracy of a world kitchen, where rich and poor share and share alike." You would swear Stealth Chef was about to break into doomed and righteous song at the barricades in Les Mis. All the PC words got gonged. Democracy, rich, poor, world, share. The result in the year Stealth Chef had been on the air was a ratings top spot as unassailable as my own Chef Claudio Orlandini's five-tier tiramisu. But everyone loved Stealthy's mystique, the bandana, the head wrap, the voice changer, pure theater. The problem with all this televised celebrity was that it started to give Rosa Bari ideas. Would Chef consider a gold hoop earring, a fish tattoo, a paisley ascot, a nose job? Thankfully, she voiced these abominations only to Pete or to me, on some level knowing better than to make any direct suggestions to Anna Maria or Chef himself. The two times Chef wandered through the common room when Stealth Chef was on the air, he truly stopped dead in his tracks, transfixed as though he had spotted the East African oryx on the Serengeti plain. He seemed okay with the disguises. After all, Chef's easy charm was probably in the same league as Stealth Chef's bandana. But his eyes widened in shock when the whole concept of recipes for all got plugged. You would think he was watching either an autopsy or a student with bad knife skills. Right there in front of him.
"Cosa sta dicendo?" he declared.
"What is he saying?" Then, hoarsely,
"Ricette per tutti?"
Recipes for all? He was baffled. With arms open wide, Chef Claudio Orlandini turned slowly, addressing the walls in broken English. "Where, then, is the art, the pricelessness?" Palming a few cubes of fresh mozzarella from the antipasto tray, plus two slender breadsticks, I motioned to Rosa and Sophia to turn off the TV. Sophia, who was in charge of the remote at that moment in time, clicked it once, and both of them headed like long-suffering galley slaves toward the classroom stainless steel tables. We all sat. Pete dashed in and scraped over a chair he flipped around and straddled. Chef's only son was 40, with short dark hair, hazel eyes, and angular cheekbones. He loved his father without losing sight of the man's shortcomings, and he became my friend one night over dinner at a time when a murder too close to home nearly derailed all of us. Over the past weeks, I had been developing both a startup cooking school and a fondness for this man who could turn a beautiful black Moriolo olive between his fingers and gaze at it like it had a story and the value of a diamond. Anna Maria, dressed in an elegant navy blue sheath, dropped straight-backed onto a bench and folded her hands prayerfully. A former nun herself, Anna Maria slid in and out of this default position. We smiled and tipped our heads at each other as if we were meeting after a very long time away. At length, she began to pour tea. Sophia passed a plate of rolled and speared anchovies. Pete popped a couple of olives. Rosa appeared to be daydreaming. I had 6 sets of photocopied information collated and stapled. These I passed out in a silent rustle, setting chefs next to me until he returned from the bocciodromo, the indoor bocce dome, and joined us. He never fretted, sensing, I'm pretty convinced, that when I showed up last month, fretting was penciled into my job description. I nostri studenti domani. In my half-baked Italian, I drew their attention to the top sheet. Manny Manfredi of Cucinavan had sent me a nice printout of the Americans who had signed up, not to mention paid up, for Marinara Misteriosa. Alongside each alphabetized name was age, permanent address, and occupation. I went down the list. Jenna Bond, 24, Baltimore, Maryland, barista, Artifact Coffee. Zoe Campion, 34, Chatham, New Jersey, outdoor educator, Walden Trails School. Glynis Graham, 53, Naples, Florida, owner, Gulf Coast Apparel. Robert Graham, 54, Naples, Florida, owner, Graham's Lambs Dealership. George Johnson, 37, Brooklyn, New York, server, Fresh Take Bistro. Anna Maria perused the list with a scowl, then swatted it lightly with the back of her hand.
Only one, how you say, cook.
I turned to her. Which one? All 3 Bari sisters answered at once with many shrugs.
Giorgio.
I looked at the entry for George Johnson, not seeing what to them as they sat with folded hands was obvious. Why do you say that? At their blank looks, I tried again.
Perché?
As she fussed at the clip that held back one side of her salt and pepper hair, Anna Maria blinked at the ceiling.
Bistro.
Sophia and Rosa nodded vigorously at their elder sister's sagacity. I held up a finger. Not my first choice. Actually, I raised my voice, quickly muttering out of the side of my mouth to Pete. Jump in, okay? All we know about Giorgio is that he's a waiter. Cameriere, capisce? Which doesn't mean he cooks. This brilliant deduction was met with appreciative murmurs from my colleagues. I went on. Judging by the scant information we have on our first group of students, we can't make any inferences about who comes to us with cooking skills and who doesn't. 3 faces turned in unison to Pete, whose melodious Italian translated my point. I sipped my tea. Then I launched into what I always think of as my battle station speech, developed over my lengthy career of designing cooking schools, 4 total, including this Orlandini gig, and which I distilled down to 3 rules. For these, I pushed back my chair and stood at my place.
Uno,
I bleated. Assume no kitchen skills. They are here to learn, so we will teach them. Whether they're good or they're bad, show no shock. We work with what we've got. I inhaled and delivered the most craven part of the battle station speech. Insofar as we can, I scanned their intense faces. We give them some tips. We give them some recipes, some wine, time in the presence of our celebrity chef, and we send them off happy. We are selling the Orlandini Cooking School experience. Their faces hadn't changed.
Due,
I went on, regarding the ceiling. No fraternizing. In Italian, Pete went on a little long on this point, I thought, ruling out lovers, pals, drinking buddies, dance partners, roommates, and piano accompanists. At that one, I eyed him. He studied a stunted olive. Then I grabbed the list of names and waved it around. These are our customers. Do you understand?
Our students, amended Anna Maria,
trying for the high road. I think she was privately savoring an image of these five Americans as holy seekers. Had she not been listening to rule number one? I pressed my lips together.
Our customers, I repeated. We will be living here in close quarters.
Pete was all over this half-sentence like shine on polyester. Rosa made a catcall. So we behave with the utmost professionalism at all times.
No hello?
Of course hello. Be cordial and helpful at all times. When I saw how wide their eyes were with this, well, loophole, I fretted. All I could throw on top of rule number two was something about thinking of these five American gastro-tourists as shoppers who have entered our retail establishment. We want to sell them our goods, but we want to respect their space. Pete apparently thought it advisable at this point to encourage some role-playing, because before my very eyes, Rosa and Sophia moved quickly away from the table. Wringing her hands, Rosa smiled dementedly at Sophia.
I show you a, how you say, sauté pot.
Pan.
Anna Maria scrutinized her fingernails as though she had been saying pan all of her 60 years.
Yes,
murmured Sophia, flushed with competence.
You do.
Keeping the kind of distance from her customer I recalled from the leper colony scene in Ben-Hur, Rosa waved her all the way out of the common room, then turned and curtsied. We all clapped and clapped again when Sophia skipped back in and took a bow. I debated finessing the performance, but decided against it, finally. They got the basics just fine. Sell them on the Orlandini experience, but respect their space. Pete said,
What's next?
I nodded at him and sang out,
Tray.
Speared anchovies, cubed cheeses, stemmed pepperoncini paused in midair. I had their attention. Refer all suggestions and complaints to... For a nanosecond of horror, I realized I hadn't worked out this point. Who was the go-to for the program? Not Chef. Not unless it had something to do with asking him whether the dough was stretchy enough. Not Anna Maria. Although I considered her, she was, after all, inner circle. But even after our short acquaintance, I knew this woman's realm was the kitchen, at Chef's side, and she was stunningly single-minded. Although he handled the villa accounts, so he had a finger on the business side of things. Still, he was chin-deep in the olive harvest and could only be called on occasionally as an instructor, depending. I eyed him. He scratched his nose and gave me a tight little smile. In a moment of honesty, rumbling deep inside myself, I realized I didn't want to designate him the go-to for live suggestions and complaints, because I could just imagine the customers manufacturing suggestions and complaints just to sidle up to him. The bath water's too hot. Chef is too remote. I need more practice with the gnocchi board, the polenta whisk, the pasta maker. That would simply not do. No siree. Pete seemed to read my mind. Was I that obvious? Leaning closer, he said quietly,
I can take care of myself, Nell.
When I was about to sputter something by way of reply, he held up a hand.
I'm happy to do it, if you want me to.
After a moment, my shoulders slumped as I let out a long breath. Then I finished rule number three. Refer all suggestions and complaints, I intoned, to me. At the three other sites where I had designed and developed cooking schools, there was enough staff to lay this disagreeable part of the operation off on program managers or assistants to the chief operating officer. Here, there was just me. No organizational chart. Just, basically, a family.
Hey, cried Rosa appreciatively. La bella Nella. Before turning to page 2 of the handout, I shivered. Someone must have left the door open, as my gaze slid over the names of our first small group of American gastro-tourists. Jenna, Zoe, Glynis, Robert, and George. At the time, I had no way of knowing that one of them would never make it home. Chapter 2. When the antipasti ran out, so did my colleagues. Even Pete begged off.
"I can still harvest a few more trees," he explained apologetically, "before I lose the light."
Rosa and Sophia had been helping him in the grove over the busiest time of the olive harvest, but I claimed them for good as the advent of Cucina Van and Marinara Misteriosa neared. He relinquished the nimble and game Bari sisters with good grace. These two were on semi-permanent loan from their convent. The villa, declared the Mother Superior I had not yet met, can be viewed as in need of our pastoral aid. Although I suspected she was being glib and saw a great opportunity to rid the Veronican community of the restless youngest two Bari sisters, I was grateful to have them. The remaining sister, Jada, couldn't be spared from the convent. On the eve of what I could tell from her expression Anna Maria saw as the outbreak of the plague, we were all informed we were on our own for dinner. Anna Maria had a few last-minute adjustments to the kitchen. As she left the common room, pushing the tea cart straight-backed, she looked as though she wanted a few minutes alone with the stove and the frigorifero to exhort them to be brave.
"Nella mattina," I called after the three of them. "Discutiamo il primo giorno."
In the morning, we discussed the first day. From the door to the courtyard, Pete smiled at me.
"I didn't even need to translate."
I bucked up. "Can you meet me later in the office? I think we'll be okay if at least you and I understand the day's schedule."
"I'll bring some wine."
Also, it occurred to me, "Chef, bring Chef." I threw up my hands. "He can't wing it. He's not just cooking for the next 4 days, Pete."
I know. He's teaching.
And inspiring and charming. What else could I add? He is the cooking school at the Villa Orlandini. I waved the class list like I was clearing the air, which maybe I was. What these 5 first-timers think of their experience here will make or break us. It's that simple. Their reviews will turn up everywhere. Yelp, TripAdvisor, personal blogs, you name it. Pete started over to me.
"I know Pop can be a wild card, but he'll come through," he said softly. "You'll see."
His trust in his father was so complete, it was touching. But what I couldn't gauge was whether it was misplaced. I gave him a wan smile and watched him hurry off to the waiting olive trees, heavy with fruit. The light from the late afternoon sun fell through the common room windows in lovely floating squares, white motes hanging in soft suspension. My eyes settled on the gold leaf lettering, "Tutto Fabrodo." And although I would never admit it to anybody, I had my doubts. I had done what I could, but for some reason I felt as gloomy as Anna Maria. With her remote, disapproving personality, with Chef's mercurial behavior, and with Pete's cheerful naivete, I wondered why I ever agreed to this job. On the eve of our first public foray into cooking classes with Marinara Misteriosa, I felt more vulnerable than I ever had, even in the presence of my pushy parents as they laid out all the reasons why I should join the Dr. Val Valenti empire of cable TV psycho-shrinkage. For the first time, and in all new ways, I was utterly alone. At the end of each of the next 4 days, whatever happened, it was on me. My so-called office had been thrown together out of what had originally been the Veronican's refectory, the small communal dining hall just a few steps down from the kitchen. Now it sported one whitewashed stone wall, a great, soft area rug in a pattern of medieval rose mosaic, an executive desk with plenty of scrollwork in an antique platinum finish, and a floor lamp that Rosa let me know was particularly cool, but which reminded me of a giant tampon.
Little by little, I would sneak in a file cabinet and a bookcase from the IKEA in Florence. Turning on the tampon lamp, I sat at my fancy desk and awaited Pete and Chef. I had downed, of all things, a meatball sub I had put together for myself in the kitchen, empty of any Bari sisters, and settled into my temporary office with a brief glance out the single, arched window. It was one of those soft Tuscan nights I had come to love in a very short time, when you just know the stars will emerge if you wait long enough. And then there they'd be, silver speckles that sharpen before your very eyes. I spread out the paperwork I had prepared on Marinara Misteriosa, pulled closer the diffused light of the oven mitt-style table lamp, and looked it over. I didn't have to spend a long time with the agenda. After all, I had designed it. But I wanted to hit the most important spots, especially for the first day, with Chef and Pete. Over 4 days, Chef was demonstrating a few essential marinara sauces, made distinctive by subtle differences, and culminating grandly with his demonstration of the incomparable Prima Marinara. In the online description, we added several teasers. Will Chef Claudio Orlandini unveil a new marinara sauce, outdoing even his own famous marinara magic of 50 years ago? Will you be there when he unlocks the legendary Orlandini recipe vault? Will you be there when he divulges at long last the secret ingredient of the Prima Marinara sauce that rocketed him to fame on the culinary world stage? I banked on the mystery, the closely guarded secret, the unassailable fortress of a recipe being a draw for enrollment. But I was learning. What's the sweet spot number of years gone by when a mystery either gets enshrined in the public imagination or is just plain forgotten? The class we limited to 5 students filled, sure, but there were only 2 others on what I like to call the waiting list. 2, but not 200. Maybe puzzles like secret ingredients just get old after 50 years. It's not like bad behavior in the royal family, or the whereabouts of Captain Kidd's buried treasure. Still, I had to believe we'd catch on. So much, regardless of the field, depended on word of mouth. And over their few days with us, Zoe, Glynis, Robert, George, and Jenna would sample the best of Tuscan wines, go truffle hunting with the dog Stella, tour Pete's Silverwind Olive Grove, go mushroom picking with Chef's stately sous chef Anna Maria, dine together in the chapel, stroll the streets of Hilltop Cortona, and spend so much time in the kitchen with Chef Claudio that they would be awash in marinara and terrific stories of his life in La Cucina. The Orlandini's dream had become my dream, too. That quiet little truth came to me as a shock as I sat there next to the diffused light from my oven mitt lamp, and I shut my eyes. Outside, the night was so still I could hear the chirr of the nightjars, the tentative bark of a neighbor's dog. Nell? I opened my eyes. Backlit in the doorway to my short-term office was Pete, a wonderful addition to the quiet evening of barks and chirrs and readiness. Hey, I said, pushing back my chair as he stepped into the office, scraping his fingers through his hair. He winced. Don't you have any lights in here? Outside my immediate desk area, there wasn't much. I gave a gentle whack to the tampon floor lamp, which upped the light a notch, which was when I noticed Pete was alone. My watch surprised me. 9:12 p.m. He was an hour late. An hour late and, I craned my neck, alone. Where's Chef? When he slumped down against the wall just inside the door, I got the message this was a bigger question than I had thought. Pete? I stood up. What's wrong? One backlit arm lifted a bottle. At least I brought the wine. Where's Chef, Pete? He's fine. I left him at the hospital. The hospital? I yelled, pulling myself to my feet on muscle-free legs. What happened? They're setting his arm. His arm? He broke his arm playing bocce. I didn't even ask how that was humanly possible. It's like shuffleboard with balls. I just came home to tell you, and then I'm going back, preferably with Anna Maria. That'll fix him, I approved, Pete nodded slowly. That'll fix him. But good, I added with something as close to glee as I could muster. Now to get the full report. With shaking fingers, I pulled out two wine glasses from an otherwise empty desk drawer, then managed to ambulate over to where he sat. I had to know the worst. Which arm, Pete? I whispered. It all seemed terribly important. He pressed his eyes shut. He's right. And then the full measure of the disaster hit me. The glasses were forgotten. Sinking down next to Pete, I took a swig from the bottle. Then, in a small voice I didn't know I had, I asked, "His whisking arm?" Pete lowered his head miserably. "His whisking arm." "All right," I told myself. "All right. Now you know, Nell." Sure. Instructional whisking videos starring Chef Claudio Orlandini had been standard educational tools for years at the finest culinary schools. The man's whisking approached the speed of a major league pitcher's fastball. Urban legend has it that when Chef whisks his bechamel sauce, it's impossible for mere witnesses to see when he changes direction. And now. And now. Well, I couldn't bear to squint down whatever the long road to recovery might bring. Anything short of Chef's permanent disability would be welcome. But what about tomorrow? I felt dazed. "We can do this," I said more to myself than to Pete. As I scrambled to my feet, I thrust the bottle into his hands and told myself the kinds of things that usually buoy one up. "I'm a professional. I'm a strong woman. I'm a good person. I'm a Jersey girl. I'm a size 10, 5 feet 8 inches, a natural brunette, and I could pull off Ferragamo's cerulean blue leather paper bag waist pants. But, at the center of the room, I boiled over. "I'm a sap," I screamed. "Nell?" It felt so good, I screamed again. "Why did I take this godforsaken gig?" Flinging open the window even wider, I think I yelled to the nightjars to shut up, and then to the neighbor's dog to bark off. Stiff-armed against the window, I told myself not to take it out on Tuscany. No, not Tuscany. Not Pete, and not the Bari sisters. Pete put his arms around me. "How could he?" I sobbed. "How could he? All the time and hard work that had been put into this startup. In the past month, we had survived moss on the walls, a resident porcupine in the decrepit dormitory, Chef decamping to Rome to woo his long-lost love, and let us not forget the murder, the investigation, the killer's attempt on my own life, the liberally flung around suspicions, the bad press, the beef stew. We reacted to the pounding on the door to my office. "Fammi entrare!" It was Anna Maria. More pounding. "Pierfranco!" Pete wrenched open the door. I didn't move from the window, afraid a scene with Anna Maria would just exhaust all of us. I wanted this imperious woman in the well-worn pink chenille bathrobe to save all her best work for when she strangled the miscreant in the hospital's emergency room. In rapid Italian, Pete filled her in. She gasped and did a little two-step backward. Then she got control of herself and hissed back at him in Italian, which involved a certain amount of backlit spit. The spit of fury. New list by Nell Valenti. Orlandini's You Can Count On. At the top, Anna Maria Bari. I realized then that this was working out as well as it possibly could. I wouldn't have to go confront Chef. If he turned his limpid Al Pacino eyes on me, never mind he's in his 70s, I'd be toast, and he'd get away with having let down our side. Instead, we had the A-team. A for Anna Maria. Who needed the Furies when we had Anna Maria? Pete called back to say she was throwing on some clothes, and they'd go together to collect his pop. Or whatever was left of him when Anna Maria got through with him. My mind already on damage control, I shooed them away. Immediate goal. Finish off the wine and do whatever it takes to keep Chef out of my way until tomorrow morning. I apologized to the nightjars, who didn't believe I meant it anyway, although the dog in the night moved the barking on down the road. To his credit, he had compromised on volume and direction. From this window, I had no view of the villa's courtyard, vehicles, or drive down through the vine-covered stone entrance gates. Just as well. I wouldn't see when Pete and Anna Maria returned with the rat in Chef's clothing. Then I sank into my desk chair, booted up my Mac, tapped the tampon lamp for as high as it would go, and opened my file containing the detailed spreadsheet for events over the next 4 days of Marinara Misteriosa. Depending on just what kind of shape Chef was in, we'd have to make some last-minute accommodations to the schedule of Marinara Misteriosa. Maybe he was sidelined when it came to whisking, but we could still have him narrate the technique while Pete or Anna Maria quietly got the job done. Or, and I sat back, feeling pleased, maybe Chef could call a student up to the stove to receive Chef's one-on-one whisking tutorial. When I realized I was actually turning Chef's inability to live up to his job description into an honor conferred upon a student, I felt slightly ashamed. Nell, have you become just a spin-o-matic? When all was said and done, had I inhaled my father's televised marketing brilliance like so much secondhand smoke? I bit my lip. Then suddenly there was Rosa, padding softly across my mosaic rose rug with a tray sporting brass peacock handles and holding an insulated French press, a demi-tasse cup, and two chocolate biscotti I knew she had made just that morning. These she set down with a smile so sincere I nearly cried. Then, patting the air with a tu-tu-tu, Nella, she backed away, whispering, sta bene. It's all right. The aroma of espresso rose around me as she soundlessly drew the door shut behind her. I languidly drew the little demi-tasse spoon through the coffee. Taking my time, I sipped. Yes, I was most definitely a sap. I took a job full of drama and misapprehensions thousands of miles from my home. Accepting that truth, I dunked the first of Rosa's biscotti just to the point that, like me, it softened but didn't fall apart and sink into the rich, dark depths. About tomorrow's official opening of the Villa Orlandini Cooking School, I would figure it out. Because to offset the sap part of me, I had the professional, tough, Jersey girl part of me. Everything was in play. Sap, Jersey girl. Had I achieved a kind of equilibrium? My teeth sank unnecessarily into the espresso-soaked inch of biscotto. Truth be told, there in that solitary hidey hole, I was fond of the sap in me. It kept me safe from spin, the kind of spin that leaves nothing vulnerable in its wake. Chapter 3. Opening day of the Villa Orlandini Cooking School was a bad time to exfoliate, because apparently I had forgotten what the scrub does to my face. What I should have exfoliated was Chef. Yes, that would have been satisfying. But no one was giving me that particular delicious opportunity. And he thought his arm hurt. Ha! Just let Nell Valenti at his pores. Fortunately, I came to my senses as I was scrubbing the gritty gray paste touted as Dead Sea minerals into the top quadrant of my forehead, just along the hairline. Suddenly, I remembered the skinned look I had achieved last time and how it took 2 weeks to settle down. But it was Weehawken in the wintertime, where everyone looked angry red with the cold, the sleet, the unrelenting gray. There, I fit right in. As I stared back into the mirror over the bathroom sink at my horrified eyes, I splashed warm water onto my face, gently swiping off the hardening goop. Then I put on an off-the-rack beauty, a mink-brown wraparound shirtwaist in a cotton jersey fabric with just the right amount of slink. I especially liked the sash, which had enough material that it went into a floppy bow over my hip. Before too long, light blue Murano glass earrings dangled, a matching bracelet bangled, and Gucci blue suede slides my mother had passed on to me after wearing them twice rose to the occasion of style and reasonably good sense. Cucina Van was rolling in around 2 p.m., so I was ready to walk out my bedroom door a full 8 hours ahead of schedule. It was game on. Holding my slim leather portfolio against my chest, I click-clacked my way up the paved path to the cloister walk and the entrance to the main building. The Ape, our little blue farm truck, stood by, waiting for an outing, but the vintage ocean green T-bird was gone. With incredible sang-froid, I found myself wondering if Chef had run away again. Perhaps Rome? Perhaps Calabria, where the shepherds roam? Perhaps back to the Bocciodromo, to break his other arm? I couldn't possibly care less. We would manage. I pushed open the door into the kitchen, where I caught Anna Maria and Chef in a hug, or half a hug, considering the sling. When they saw me, they sprang apart guiltily. Clearly, someone had to be the Anna Maria in the room. "That's telling him," I said icily. Anna Maria looked as if she had been exfoliating too. While Chef played for sympathy by turning those Pacino peepers on me, she scrabbled for some Italian equivalent of a high road. First, she sniffed. And then, if she lifted her chin any higher, it could turn on the hood fan over the range.
"I apologize to Chef," she explained with an elegant shrug. "For bad things, I say."
Or, more likely, I smirked, the battery of malocchi she had flung like Zeus at him. A man could stand just so many curses. Chef saw his chance.
È vero, Nella."
Then he crossed his heart with the claw-like fingers of his immobilized arm. In my head, which was starting to ache, I expunged the name of Anna Maria Bari from the list of dependable Orlandinis. The only name left was Pete's. I was beginning to feel my zen, null-set, black-hole equanimity seep back into my cells. And then, Chef tucked his head in around his collar in what he thought was a conciliatory manner. In English, he tried,
"You look very pretty today."
My nose started to twitch. I wanted to hoot and blather in gibberish in his face, but in a reasonable voice, I responded, "That's as may be, Chef, but we have work to do." I turned, blinking, at Anna Maria. "Are there any scones?" Wordlessly, she opened one arm in a priestly half-benediction, drawing my gaze to the platter on the table. Two scones. Hoarded, probably, for those fallen from grace in the kitchen. Instead, I claimed them. Let them eat toast. Daring the two with a mere look to stop me, I took a cloth napkin, gathered up both scones, the coffee carafe, a cup, and my portfolio, and announced I would be breakfasting in my office and would see them both at 9 a.m. for final instructions. On my way out, just trying to hang on to all the things I was taking with me, I paused. "Chef?"
"Si,"
came a satisfyingly small voice. Without turning, I spoke. "I recommend changing into the Lagerfeld shirt for the first day." At 9, more or less, this was Italy, after all, Baris and Orlandinis assembled in my office. Pete had brought Laura and Lisa, two more of Anna Maria's sisters, over from the convent to lend a hand during Marinara Misteriosa. These two were twins with bowl-cut bangs and chin-length hair. Sturdy women with the kinds of hands you see in boxing gyms, who fell somewhere in the middle of the Bari birth order. They could make beds, sanitize bathrooms, lug 50-pound sacks of potatoes, and knock heads together if necessary. Sadly, they seemed to go in fear of Chef himself, which seriously limited their ability to crack their 20 collective knuckles with gusto and keep him in line. I handed them each a single sheet, the agenda for day one. In English. While they stood shuffling from foot to foot in front of me, I sat with my fingers steepled on my desk. Pete made his way in Italian down the agenda items. Manny Manfredi, which somehow Pete managed to make sound like a scourge, arrives at 2 p.m., at which time we make introductions and show our students to their lodgings. At 6 p.m., we convene in the common room for Chef's official welcome. From a look on his face, which he disguised quickly, I could tell it was the first he had heard of this duty, which, of course, it wasn't. Following this inspiring welcome, all students receive their course packets and are given a tour of the villa facilities by Pete and Nell. At 8 p.m., dinner in La Cappella, thanks to Chef.
thanks to Anna Maria Bari, who provides an array of the marinara sauces they will be learning during their stay. Visiting sommelier and vintner Teresa Franchi will be on hand to decant a selection of local wines. Pete made it all sound fairly easy, even in Italian. Everyone left, including me. On our way out, I noticed they seemed clear on last-minute jobs, and Chef loped off toward his apartment, presumably to write the welcome speech he had left to the very last minute. Considering he was right-handed, I had no idea how he planned to pull off this task, but I decided to let him wrestle with the problem for, a good 2 or 3 hours before offering to help. For the next few hours, I inspected. I even put on my designer reading glasses to peruse, whatever I wanted to peruse. Sophia showed me around the physical spaces the 5 Americans would be using. In addition to the kitchen, the common room, and the chapel, 2 formal dinners were planned, there were the accommodations. We booked the Grahams into the converted barn studio apartment, at a higher rate. The other 3, Zoe Campion, Jenna Bond, and George Johnson, were roughing it in the brightly painted rooms on the 2nd floor of the old nun's dormitory, each outfitted with a twin bed, a dresser, a nightstand, an easy chair, and lush area rugs. They sparkled. They gleamed. True, they smelled a little like ammonia, but that would pass. The door to the 1st floor of the dormitory, where Chef's living quarters and Anna Maria's room were located, was kept locked, yielding to a keycard system we had installed just 3 days ago. Since then, Chef had misplaced his keycard 5 times. Life was long. Life was hard. Finally, I was back in my office, hoping to meditate, English for nap, behind closed doors until the witching hour of 2 o'clock befell us and the Cucina van deposited 5 Americans on our doorstep. But at the precise moment I had slid out of Mom's slides and stretched out on the rug, a knock came at the door. Do not disturb signs mean nothing anymore? Nella? It was Rosa, but muffled and wheezy. I always open doors to Rosa. She sings a mean Billy Joel and understands things like irony. Together we were working on absurdity. It wouldn't take long. We were naturals. But when I swung open the door, patting my hair in place, pulling my snipped lock over the exfoliated part of my forehead, I couldn't immediately find her. I felt like I had tumbled down Alice's rabbit hole, and it was a forest of floral arrangements as tall as lemon trees. Rosa? I called, and she pushed her way out from behind the closest arrangement, fashioned into an arbor of intense, eye-watering lilies. What's all this? I cried, and she gave me a look like she might be ready to graduate from our absurdity study sessions. All I could get out of her was, flower truck make delivery, then go. Rosa thrust a card at me. Mille Fiore was the name of the business responsible for this tasteless jungle of flora. In English, 1,000 flowers, and I could swear there were more than that many outside my office door. I swatted at them, taking in 6 varieties of lilies. Oriental lilies, Turk's cap lilies, trumpet lilies, Easter lilies, day lilies, hybrid lilies. As I brought the card close to my face, wheezing. Get rid of them, Rosa. There were enough death flowers here for a state funeral. And then I saw. Congrats on your 1st day, honey. We always knew you could do it. We love you, Mom and Dad. Of course. Of course. Dr. Val and Artis Valenti. Who else? They had been plying me with the lilies they never seemed to recall I'm allergic to for the last 16 years, ever since the winter sports banquet at my high school, when all I got was a certificate for participating on the freshman girls' tennis team. Pretty much my job was running after balls, either with or without a racket in my hands. My parents had actually hired a handsome young man, dressed in a tux, to present me with an armful of lilies. I learned, in that moment, 2 things. The girl who had served and forehanded and backhanded the team to the regional finals got a trophy for MVP that looked puny by comparison to my lilies. And I knew it was all wrong. I also learned why these overdone flowers were associated with death and funerals. Because if you weren't dead already, you were, like me as I struggled to breathe, well on the way. I glanced again at the card. We always knew you could do it. No, they didn't. And their guilt on that score made them overdo it. The Bari sisters hauled the death arrangements all the way outside, and out of their tender hearts deployed a few here and there. The arbor got positioned in front of the entrance to the main building. The floral blanket was arranged over one of the rails in the split rail fence bordering Pete's olive grove. Standing arrangements flanked the garage doors and the dormitory. The rest adorned the compost heap behind the barn. Then the sisters cranked and pushed open all the windows in and around my office. Me, I fled to my room, then dug around in my travel bag and took some hits on my inhaler. By the time I blew my nose and blotted my watery eyes, I was feeling pretty restored. Just in time to greet Kuchinavan, which tour operator Manny Monfredi was swinging in a wide arc around the villa's courtyard, honking merrily and finally coming to a stop. Never mind he was half an hour early. Pete and I exchanged a meaningful look, and he took off in the direction of the dormitory. Chances were 50-50 that his pop was groomed, dental bridge in place, pate gleaming, hands washed, scents applied, and dressed. Pete would alert him to the early arrival. I had nauseating visions of Chef bow-legging it toward our five American foodies dressed in his form-fitting spandex bocce pants. If just one person can be...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.